there. This is Dr. Mohin Haseeb, the accreditation consultant and quality and safety trainer, with another topic on accreditation and the quality and safety in clinical laboratories. Today's topic is individualized quality control plan, IQCP. And this is lesson one. If you are feeling like this with the IQCP plan, by the time I'm done with you, you will be smiling like that. I'm gonna make it easy for you on how to deal with the IQCP. In lesson one, I'm gonna give you a brief quality control history, and I'm gonna give you the definition of an IQCP. And what are the rationale for moving to IQCP per CAB and CLIA and CMS and all that? Why do you need IQCP in your laboratory? What are the CAB requirements for IQCP? And in lesson two, we'll talk about what are the elements of an IQCP. And we're gonna start talking on how do you implement or develop these elements. And in lesson three, we'll continue with how to implement or develop the elements of IQCP. And I'll tell you where to begin and a subject summary. So a brief quality control history. In 1967, the Clinical Laboratory Improvement Act, CLIA 67, set guidelines that regulated laboratories that did business with the patient paid by the U.S. The U.S. government. So, and then a CLIA 88 published in 1992. So remember, this was in 1967, and then in 1992, CLIA published set forth a new regulation for personal standards, specimen management, quality control, quality assurance, and proficiency testing for anyone doing laboratory testing. Then CLIA 88 mandated that testing lab must follow manufacturer requirement or run two levels of QC per day, which is called default QC. This is a term that you need to remember. Running two levels of QC per day, default QC, which they consider now one size fits all. Okay, then the CMS, the the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services, published their quality systems regulation in 2004, which allowed the use of what they call equivalent QC, EQC. Equivalent QC means reduced QC. It allows a laboratory to reduce the QC from daily to once a week or once a month after they do a study for 20 or 30 days, demonstrating that the QC is within the range during these days, and there is no issue with the QC system that they have. So in 2004, CMS published their quality system regulations, which allowed the use of EQC testing as a voluntary alternative to default EQC. And we said default EQC is running two levels of QC on the day when you are doing patient testing. EQC was meant to minimize the frequency of external QC that was required to control laboratory test systems, to help save cost and resources for laboratories, and to acknowledge the technical advances in for the instruments and the equipments and machines. And this is a key statement here, okay? Since then, the CDC and CMS had many meetings trying to come up with a better way to do QC, but these meetings met with limited success. Then the government, okay, the government went to the private, okay, went to the private. In 2005, CMS, the government, reached out to CLSI, Clinical Laboratory, Clinical Laboratory Standard Institute, to facilitate the development of a scientific, objective, consensus QC guidelines. So in 2005, CLSI held their first meeting called the QC for the Future. And in 2011, from 2000, they kept meeting from 2005 to 2011. And after, in 2011, after they came up with the EP23 Laboratory Quality Control based on risk assessment. And they published it in October 2011. Then CMS incorporated the EP23 of CLSI in 2013. They incorporated it in the CLIA Interpretive Guidelines QC policy. And they mandate that every lab use the EP23, okay, guidelines. So this is the history basically of the QC between 1967 and 2013. Now, individualized quality control plan. What is it? What is the definition of an IQCP? It is a frame for customizing a quality control program for your test systems and your laboratory unique environment. By performing steps in an IQCP, you will examine the potential sources of error in your entire testing process, pre-analytical, analytical, and post-analytical phases. Thus, your laboratory will need to consider the corresponding risks associated with each one of these phases to reduce the likelihood of error occurring in your laboratory, as I will describe to you in these lessons. So QC in the laboratory has traditionally focused on the analytical phase of testing. This may not be sufficient to ensure strong process control for all test systems in all environments throughout the entire process. IQCP is the alternative for CLIA equivalent QC testing to meet the regulations for non-wave tests. IQCP includes many practices that your laboratory already engaged in to ensure quality testing, not just the frequency and number of QC materials. So adoption of an IQCP will not necessarily reduce QC testing practices. It doesn't mean that you're gonna implement IQCP, that you're gonna reduce how many times you're gonna do QC in your lab. Okay, it could reduce, it could increase, it could remain the same. Okay, so it will allow you though to develop customized QC for your laboratory, for the specimen you test, their reagent, their test system, their environment, and the testing personnel. After you complete this process, the IQCP process, it is possible that you may determine that the amount of QC you are doing is sufficient to achieve compliance. Or or you could discover potential source of error that you had not previously considered and may need to implement additional QC activities. Now, is IQCP a must? Do you have to do it, or does the lab have to do it? Okay. Not really, no. IQCP is a voluntary optional for laboratories. However, if you don't participate in IQCP, if you are eligible, okay, your laboratory must perform a traditional default QC for non-wave testing. And we said non-wave tests that employ, not all the non-wave tests, non-wave test that has an internal or electronic or built-in QC system. And electronic controls are internal part of the analyzer test system that monitor electrical or electronic component of the system. So exception to that, microbiology identification and susceptibility systems. Even if they don't have built-in or electronic QC, they still need to implement IQCP if they don't want to run control every day of testing, run two levels of control every day of testing. Also, for PNP, ISTAT, non-wave cartridges only, ACT, PT, GenExpert, also they all, the IQCP is applicable to all of these tests. For pathology testing, even if they have a built-in QC system or control, they are exempt from this IQCP requirement. So we said IQCP is a voluntary option, but if you don't want to participate in it, the lab must perform traditional default QC for non-wave tests that employ electronic or procedure built-in controls. And also by running for qualitative testing, a positive and a negative QC each day each day you do patient testing. And for a quantitative test, you need to run two levels of QC each day you do patient testing. QC cannot be less, though, than what the manufacturer required. Okay, so if they require three levels of QC, then you cannot do two levels. You need to do three levels, okay? So QC cannot be less than frequent than what the manufacturer required, but manufacturer recommendation also cannot be less than two levels of external QC each day of testing. So if they tell you just run one level, you cannot just run one level. You need to meet the minimum requirement, which is two levels of QC each day patient testing is done. Equivalent QC was discontinued and no longer acceptable as of January 1, 2016 per CAB. You cannot use equivalent QC anymore. In short, laboratories must choose either to do traditional default QC by running two levels of QC each day patient testing is done, or you need to implement an IQCP plan for all new and existing test system must be in compliance, no exceptions if the IQCP is applicable to them. What are the rationale for moving to IQCP? They say changes in healthcare environment and delivery of service, advances in technology. CLIA equivalent to QC, one size fits all, no longer suitable, proved to be too limited and rigid. Also, need a flexible program for the future that evaluate the entire testing process. Why do you need IQCP in your laboratory? First, to provide customizable broad framework for unique QC plan for each non-wave test, include specimen, environment, test system, personnel, etc. Uses data and information already available in your laboratory. Risk assessment, review, and documentation lead to comprehensive QC plan with appropriate controls, quality activities, and quality assessment. Optimize the use of electronic internal controls. Adopt testing practices for advances or future technology. Strengthen partnership with manufacturers. And because Cap said so, even if you are not convinced about all these rationales, all these reasons, Cap said you need to implement IQCP if you don't want to run default QC. What are the CAB requirements for an IQCP? Of course, these requirements I'm going to talk about, they all found in the old common checklist, but there might be an additional requirements found in the discipline checklist, like in microbiology or molecular or something. So, in the first requirement found in OLCAM 50200, list of individualized quality control plan. The lab has identified all the tests using an IQCP on the CAB list of IQCP form. CAB has a form, I'll show you, I'll show it to you in a minute. If you need to list on it, all the sections with all the IQCP plans for each section on that form. You can download the form from cab.org. This is the link for it. Or the use of the CAB form is required even if the lab has its own form and template. This, you go to CAB website, you go to IQCP resources, and this is where you find the form. List of individualized quality control plans form. And that's how the form will look like. You need to fill as applicable. And you need to send to CAB with your application or when they ask for it. The next requirement is found in COM 50300, risk assessment. The IQCP for a test or a device or an instrument include a risk assessment to evaluate potential sources of error to include all of the following: pre-analytical, analytical, post-analytical phases of the testing process. It needs to include intended medical uses of the test and impact if inaccurate results are reported, like clinical risk. It needs to include component of the test including reagent, environment, specimen, testing personnel, and test system. It needs to include variation in the component based on the use of the test. It needs to include data from the laboratory's own environment, instrument, equipment, and performance, and testing personnel demonstrating acceptable performance over the maximum time interval between external quality control run defined in the IQCP. Manufacturer's instructions and recommendations need to be followed. The next requirement by CAP for the IQCP is found in Common 50400, quality control plan, QCP. and they talk about the approval of this QC plan. The IQCB includes a written QCB approved by the medical director prior to implementation. The QCB may be part of a test procedure or be a separate written plan. As an efficiency, a single plan may address multiple tests performed in one on one device. A separate QCB approved by the medical director must be in place for each lab with a separate CAB CLIA number. This is for US lab and or for each non-US lab in the same system. So if you have two labs under the same system, you need to have separate QCP approved by the medical director. So the IQCP must include the following parameters as applicable: the number, the type, and the frequency of the QC. Two, criteria for acceptable performance. Three, monitoring of the test environment and reagent. Four, specimen quality. Five, instrument calibration, maintenance, and function checks. Six, training and competency of testing personnel. Seven, provisions for multiple identical devices and variations for uses covered under one IQCP. Next, you need to include the components of QCB must meet regulatory and CAB accreditation requirement and be in compliance with the manufacturer instructions at minimum. Also, the quality control plan need to include control the quality of the test process and ensure accurate and reliable test result. Also, external quality control material sample must be analyzed with a new lot and shipment of reagents or more frequently if indicated in the manufacturer instructions. Next requirement is found in CAM 50600, quality assessment monitoring. Ongoing quality assessment QA monitoring include recording of the following: review of QC and instrument equipment maintenance and function check data at least monthly. So you need to review the quality the quality control and the maintenance for the QCP or for the IQCP at least monthly. Evaluation of error relating to pre-analytical, analytical, and post-analytical phases of the testing process. We need to review review of compliance from complaints, review of complaints from clinicians and other healthcare providers regarding the quality of testing to confirm the clinical efficiency of testing. Evaluation of corrective action taken if problems are identified. Re-evaluation of the QCP if changes to the reagent, environment, specimen, testing personnel, or test system elements of the risk assessment occurs. Re-approval of the quality control plan by the laboratory director or designee at least every other year, every 2 years. If ongoing assessment identify failures in one or more components of the QCP, the laboratory must investigate the cause and consider if modifications are needed to the QCP to mitigate the potential risk. An example form is available on the CAB website for the IQCP resources pages that may be used to record an annual assessment of the IQCP. So in addition to your monthly assessment, you need an annual assessment, and you can use this form if you like, or your own form. Eligibility for the use of IQCP is limited to testing meeting all of the following criteria. It has to be a non-wave test, so wave test is not applicable. Wave test that employ an internal or built-in quality control system. And we said the exception for that are in microbiology for the identification system and the sustainability system. Even if they don't have a built-in controls, the IQCP is still applicable to them. Okay, and then also a test performed in specialty other than the anatomic pathology and cytopathology. So if there is a method or a test or an instrument that is non-waved and it's has a built-in QC, and if that instrument you have that instrument in pathology and one like in molecular, then the instrument in molecular you have to do the IQCP for it if you want to reduce the amount of QC done. Okay, but in histology and cytology, even if they have the same instrument, they are exempt. Okay, I'll give you a tip. You search tool is available on the FDA website to confirm the complexity of the test performed and can be assessed at this website. This will tell you if it's waved, non-waved, okay, where you and to assess if you need to, if the IQCP is applicable to your method or instrument or not. Laboratories may develop their own model for the designing an IQCP, or they can use the CLSI guideline EB23, or use the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services, CMS resources, or use manufacturer vendor protocol, or use other commercially available products. However, a laboratory may not implement an IQCP that allow for quality control to be performed less frequently than indicated in the manufacturer instructions. The components of the QCP must meet regulatory and CAB accreditation requirements and be in compliance with the manufacturer instructions at minimum. I am done with the first lesson on IQCP. To continue with the subject, please go to lesson 2. And in lesson 2, we'll talk about what are the elements of an IQCP, and we will start talking about on how do you implement or develop these elements. Thank you very much for watching.